Hello, I'm Ross Smith, Deputy Director of the International Public Sector Accounting Standards Board, the IPSASB. With me is João Carlos Fonseca, Manager, Standards Development and Technical Projects at the IPSASB. Welcome to this webinar, Leases, an Introduction to ED 64. The webinar will provide an introduction to key features of the ED. You may also find helpful the at-a-glance summary, which is available on the IPSASB's website at www.ipsasb.org. Today's webinar will cover seven aspects related to ED 64. The development of the ED, the economics of the right-of-use model, scope, the definition of a lease, lessor accounting, lessee accounting, and sale and leaseback transactions. At the end of the webinar, I'll cover the next steps for this project. The IPSASB Leases project has three key influences. João, can you explain those and their importance in developing ED 64?
Thanks, Ross. The IPSASB decided that the Leases project is a convergence project because in developing IPSAS 13 leases, the IPSASB had concluded that the economics of a lease transaction were the same in both the public sector and the private sector. As a consequence, the first influence is the IPSASB's policy paper process for reviewing and modifying ISB documents, also known as rules of the road. According to the rules of the road, when determining whether public sector issues warrant a departure from an ISB document, the IPSASB considers the following: whether applying the requirements of the ISB document would mean that the objectives of public sector financial reporting would not be adequately met, whether applying the requirements of the ISB document would mean that the qualitative characteristics of public sector financial reporting would not be adequately met, and whether applying the requirements of the ISB document would require undue cost or effort. And this takes us to the second and third influences. The process requires IPSASB to take its decisions in the context of consistency with IPSASB's conceptual framework for general purpose financial reporting by public sector entities, the conceptual framework, and internal consistency with existing IPSAS. Consistency with the statistical basis of accounting is also required. However, as IPSAS 13 is aligned with IS 17 rather than with GFS, and IFRS 16 was published after the most recent GFS manuals, the IPSASB decided to converge with IFRS 16 instead of aligning with GFS. Let's look how the rules of the road influence the IPSASB's leases project. The right-of-use model for lessee accounting in IFRS 16 is consistent with the conceptual framework because the right-of-use asset satisfies the definition of and recognition criteria for an asset in the IPSASB's conceptual framework, and the right-of-use asset is recognized when the lessee controls the asset, which is consistent with the conceptual framework. It should be noted that the risks and rewards incidental to ownership model in IPSAS 13 is not based on control and is therefore not consistent with the conceptual framework. Overall, the information reported under the single lessee accounting model specified in IFRS 16 will provide the most useful information to the broadest range of users of financial statements, prevents arbitrage, gaming, and information asymmetry, and improves comparability between public sector entities that lease assets and public sector entities that purchase assets. Consequently, the IPSASB agreed that there were no public sector issues that warranted a departure from the right-of-use model for lessee accounting in IFRS 16. The right-of-use model is appropriate for public sector financial reporting. The IPSASB therefore agreed to develop revised lessee accounting requirements that were converged with the requirements in IFRS 16.
Thanks, João. However, for lessors, the ED is proposing a different accounting model from IFRS 16. Can you tell us why the IPSASB decided to depart from IFRS 16 for lessor accounting?
Thanks, Ross. When reviewing IFRS 16, the IPSASB noted that IFRS 16 retained the risks and rewards incidental to ownership model previously applied in IAS 17 and IPSAS 13 for lessors. In this context, the IPSASB considered whether there were any public sector issues that warranted a departure from the lessor accounting approach in IFRS 16 using the rules of the road methodology that had also applied to lessee accounting. In so doing, the IPSASB came to the conclusion that the risks and rewards incidental to ownership model is not based on control and therefore is not consistent with the conceptual framework. The risks and rewards incidental to ownership model does not distinguish between the right of use asset and the underlying asset. The IPSASB considered these to be different economic phenomena that should be accounted for separately. Under the risks and rewards incidental to ownership model, a lessor that classifies a lease as operating lease would not recognize a lease receivable. The IPSASB considered that leases are in substance financing transactions and that the lease receivable meets the definition of a financial asset in IPSAS 28, financial instruments presentation. In the same way, if a lessor classified a lease as a finance lease, would derecognize the underlying asset. The IPSASB is of the view that a lease conveys the right to use an underlying asset for a period of time and does not transfer control of the underlying asset to an entity. Transactions that do transfer control are sales or purchases within the scope of other standards, for example, IPSAS 9, revenue from exchange transactions, or IPSAS 17, property, plant and equipment. Therefore, the IPSASB considered that the lessor should not derecognize the underlying asset in a lease transaction. The IPSASB is also of the view that the risks and rewards incidental to ownership model does not satisfy the objectives of public sector financial reporting in the conceptual framework. The lessor would not be providing complete information about the entity's management of the resources entrusted to it for the delivery of services to constituents and others, as the financial statements would omit either the information on the underlying asset or the lease receivable. Applying a risks and rewards model to lessor accounting, while applying a control model to lessee accounting, would be inconsistent with the IPSASB's existing literature. For example, IPSAS 32, Service Concession Arrangements, Grantor, which deals with transactions that have some similarities with leases, adopts a control-based model for the grantor. IFRIC 12, Service Concession Arrangements, which deals with the accounting for the operator, the other party to the transaction, also adopts a control-based model. The IPSASB also noted that applying a risk and rewards model to lessor accounting, while applying a control model to lessee accounting, would give rise to inconsistent accounting by the two parties to a lease. This could give rise to a number of practical issues in the public sector, such as consolidation issues, where the lessor and the lessee are part of the same economic entity. If the lessor classifies the lease as a finance lease, the underlying asset is not recognized by either party, and separate records will need to be maintained to report the underlying asset in the consolidated financial statements. On the other hand, if the lessor classifies the lease as operating lease, the lessor will not recognize a lease receivable, even though the lessee will recognize a lease liability. Again, additional records will be required. The use of different accounting models may make leasing transactions less understandable to some users of financial statements. It may also be difficult for users to distinguish between a lease and a sale of an asset in lessors' financial statements. Different recognition criteria for the same transaction distorts the analysis of the financial position of public sector entities, creating asymmetrical information in the public sector. The IPSASB noted that these factors are not unique to the public sector. They will apply equally in the private sector. However, they may be more prevalent in the public sector. In many jurisdictions, a centralized lessor will undertake most or all of the property management for a government. The lessor will own all the government's property assets and lease them to other government entities. As a consequence, the prevalence of consolidation issues may be greater in the public sector than in the private sector. Taking into consideration the issues discussed above, the IPSASB concluded that the retention of the IFRS 16 lessor accounting model is not appropriate for public sector financial reporting. As a consequence, the IPSASB decided to develop a single right-of-use model for lessor accounting, specifically designed for public sector financial reporting.
Thanks, João. With João's explanation, it now leads us to the main issue in ED 64, the proposal of a single right-of-use model for lease accounting. João, can you tell us what is the economic rationale behind the right-of-use model and why the IPSASB is also proposing it for lessor accounting?
Thanks, Ross. The IPSASB right-of-use model for lease accounting can be explained in six steps. The first step starts with the identified asset. As we all know, a lease starts with an identified asset that is controlled by the lessor. Therefore, the lessor continues to recognize and measure the underlying asset according to the applicable IPSAS. The second step is the lease contract. When a lease contract is signed, there is a simultaneous creation and transfer of the right-of-use asset to the lessee. This is so because IPSASB decided that a lease contract and an underlying asset are two separate economic phenomena. This is consistent with IPSAS 32 Service Concession Arrangements Grantor, where the grantor transfers the right to access to operate the service concession asset to the operator of an existing asset. In other words, the lessor is selling an asset that is not previously recognized in its financial statements. In return, the lessee transfers cash to the lessor upfront or over the lease term. However, sometimes the cash received by the lessor might not match the economic value of the right-of-use asset created by the lessor and transferred to the lessee. In this case, we are talking about leases at below-market terms or concessionary leases. But there is no doubt that the lease contract has an economic value regardless of the amount of cash being transferred. In step 3, type of lease, we accountants translate this into a simple question. Is the lease at market terms or at below-market terms? This leads us to step 4. On the analysis of the lease terms. If the lease is at market terms, then the economic value of the lease matches the cash being transferred. If the lease is at below market terms, then the economic value of the lease is higher than the cash being transferred. Step 5 is recognition. For leases at market terms, a lessor recognizes a lease receivable and a liability and earned revenue, and the lessee recognizes a right-of-use asset and a lease liability. For leases at below-market terms, a lessor recognizes a lease receivable, an expense on day one, except if it is a contribution from owners, and a liability, an earned revenue. A lessee recognizes a right-of-use asset, a lease liability, and revenue on day one, except if there is a present obligation. If there is a present obligation, the lessee recognizes a liability. The final step is step 6, measurement. For leases at market terms, the measurement basis is historical cost because it is consistent with IPSASB literature to measure exchange transactions. For leases at below market terms, the measurement basis is a fair value because it is also consistent with IPSASB literature to measure non-exchange transactions and concessionary loans. Therefore, both measurement bases are expected to result in more comparable information with other similar transactions. Further ahead in this presentation, we'll explain in more detail recognition and measurement for both lessors and lessees. In the end, the IPSASB is proposing the right-of-use model in lessor accounting because it is consistent with the conceptual framework, it is consistent with a control-based approach to the recognition of assets, because a lease does not transfer control of the underlying asset. It is consistent with the grant of a right to the operator model in IPSAS 32, where a liability, an earned revenue, is initially recognized in the statement of financial position and revenue is recognized over time in the statement of financial performance. and it is consistent with lessee accounting, as the lessee controls the right-of-use asset and the lessor controls the underlying asset, while both recognize respectively a lease liability and a lease asset.
Thanks, João. Let's now look at some other key aspects of Exposure Draft 64. João, can you explain the scope of the ED?
Thanks, Ross. The scope of Exposure Draft 64 includes all leases at market terms, concessionary leases, and right-of-use assets in a sublease. Exposure Draft 64 does not include leases to explore for or use minerals, oil, natural gas, and similar non-regenerative resources, leases of biological assets, service concession arrangements, licenses of intellectual property granted by a lessor, and rights held by a lessee under licensing agreements, such as motion picture films, video recordings, plays, manuscripts, patents, and copyrights. These are within the scope of other IPSAS. However, rights held by a lessee under licensing agreements identified earlier can be within the scope of ED64 if a lessee elects to apply it.
Thanks, João. Can you take us through the definition of a lease and the related definitions of a contract and the lease term?
Thanks, Ross. A lease is defined as follows. A lease is a contract or part of a contract that conveys the right to use an asset, the underlying asset, for a period of time in exchange for consideration. The definition relies on the other two definitions that Ross referred to. A contract is defined as follows. A contract is an agreement between two or more parties that creates enforceable rights and obligations. The right to use an asset encompasses the right to obtain economic benefits from use and the right to direct the use. The second definition is on the lease term. The lease term is the non-cancelable period for which a lessee has the right to use an underlying asset together with both. Periods covered by an option to extend the lease if the lessee is reasonably certain to exercise that option, and periods covered by an option to terminate the lease if the lessee is reasonably certain not to exercise that option. Finally, a lease must have exchange of consideration. This means that a lease for zero or nominal consideration is in substance a grant, and therefore is not a lease as defined by Exposure Draft 64.
Thanks, João. Let's now turn to the lessor accounting. ED 64 proposes separate requirements to account for the underlying asset and the lease. João, can you tell us what are those requirements and explain why the IPSASB decided to separate those requirements?
Thanks, Ross. Exposure Draft 64 proposes separate requirements to account for the underlying asset and the lease, because the IPSASB is of the view that they are separate economic phenomena and the lessor continues to control the underlying asset in a lease. This is consistent with the approach in a grant of right to the operator model with existing assets in IPSAS 32 service concession arrangement grantor. Therefore, Exposure Draft 64 proposes that the lessor shall continue to recognize and measure the underlying asset according to the applicable IPSAS. On the other hand, Exposure Draft 64 also proposes separate requirements to account for leases at market terms and at below market terms, the so-called concessionary leases, because in the public sector both types of leases are very common. Let's take a look in more detail what are the main accounting requirements in lessor accounting. When analyzing a lease contract, a lessor needs to classify a lease into lease at market terms or at below market terms. If the lease is a lease at market terms, then a lessor recognizes a lease receivable and a liability and earned revenue. The lease receivable is initially measured at the present value of future lease payments and uses the interest rate implicit in the lease. Subsequently, the lease receivable is measured at amortized cost. And the liability and earned revenue is initially measured at the initial value of the lease receivable plus the amount of any lease payments received at or before the commencement date of the lease that relate to future periods. Subsequently, the liability and earned revenue is reduced as revenue is recognized according to the substance of the lease contract. For leases at below market terms, a lessor recognizes not only a lease receivable and a liability under revenue, but also an expense on day one for the subsidy granted to the lessee, except if it is a contribution from owners. The IPSASB is of the view that recognizing the subsidy as expense on day one provides the most useful information for accountability purposes because it shows the cost of the decision to grant the concession. The lease receivable is initially measured at the present value of the future contractual lease payments using a market interest rate. Subsequently, the lease receivable is measured at the amortized cost. The liability under revenue is initially measured at the present value of market lease payments using a market interest rate. The liability under revenue represents the full economic value of the resource created, the right of use asset, and transferred to the lessee, which is higher than the future cash inflows, contractual lease payments. Subsequently, the liability under revenue is also reduced as revenue is recognized according to the substance of the lease contract. The expense or contribution from owners is measured by the difference between the liability under revenue and the lease receivable. Exposure Draft 64 also proposes recognition exemptions for short-term leases, leases of 12 months or less, for which revenue is recognized on a straight-line basis over the lease term or another systematic basis. Let's have a look in more detail at lessee accounting requirements proposed by Exposure Draft 64. Similar to lessors, when analyzing a lease contract, a lessee needs also to classify a lease into lease at market terms or at below market terms. If the lease is a lease at market terms, then a lessee recognizes a right of use asset and a lease liability. The lease liability is initially measured at the present value of the future lease payments by using the interest rate implicit in the lease, if that rate can be readily determined. If that rate cannot be readily determined, the lessee shall use the lessee's incremental borrowing rate. Subsequently, the lease liability is measured at amortized cost. The right of use asset is initially measured at the initial value of the lease liability. Subsequently, the right of use asset is measured at cost or at fair value. For leases at below market terms, a lessee recognizes a right of use asset, a lease liability, and revenue on day one, except if there is a present obligation, where specific conditions imposed on the right of use asset by the recipient result in a present obligation. Where a present obligation exists, it is recognized as a liability. The lease liability is initially measured at the present value of the future contractual lease payments using the lessee's incremental borrowing rate, if that rate can be readily determined. If that rate cannot be readily determined, the lessee shall use market interest rates. Subsequently, the lease liability is measured at amortized cost. The right of use asset is initially measured at the present value of future market lease payments, using the lessee's incremental borrowing rate, if that rate can be readily determined. If that rate cannot be readily determined, the lessee shall use market interest rates. Subsequently, the right of use asset is measured at cost or at fair value. The revenue or liability is initially measured by the difference between right of use asset and lease liability. Subsequently, if it is a liability, the liability is reduced as revenue is recognized in accordance with IPSAS 23, revenue from non-exchange transactions, taxes and transfers. Exposure Draft 64 proposes recognition exemptions for short-term leases and leases of low-value assets, for which expense is recognized on a straight-line basis over the lease term or another systematic basis.
Thanks, João. ED64 also proposes public sector-specific requirements to account for concessionary leasebacks compared to IFRS 16. Can you explain what are those public sector-specific requirements?
Thanks, Ross. Exposure Draft 64 proposes to distinguish the accounting for sale and leaseback transactions by asking whether the transfer of the asset is a sale or not. If the transfer of the asset is a sale, then the seller lessee recognizes the right of use asset measured at a proportion of the previous carrying amount of the asset that relates to the right of use, and recognizes a lease liability measured according to the requirements proposed in Exposure Draft 64. On the other hand, the buyer lessor recognizes the underlying asset and measures it according to the applicable IPSAS and recognizes the lease according to Exposure Draft 64. Exposure Draft 64 proposes to depart from IFRS 16 in the accounting for the subsidy in a concessionary leaseback. While IFRS 16 requires any below market terms to be accounted for as prepayments of lease payments, Exposure Draft 64 requires to account for the subsidy following the general guidance in ED 64 for concessionary leases for consistency reasons, and thus is expected to result in more comparable information with other concessionary leases. If the transfer of the asset is not a sale, then the seller lessee recognizes a financial liability and the buyer lessor recognizes a financial asset, both measured according to IPSAS 29.
Thanks, João. ED64 was issued at the end of January 2018. The deadline for comments is June 30th, 2018. I encourage as many of you as possible to respond. The IPSASB benefits from receiving different points of view as it seeks to finalize the standard. The IPSASB will consider a first review of responses at its September 2018 meeting and will look to issue an IPSAS on leases once it has completed this process. The target approval date for the leases IPSAS is June 2019. However, this will depend on the responses received to the ED. Thank you for viewing this webinar. For further information, please visit our webpage, www.ipsasb.org. From myself and João, thank you and goodbye.